when Don asked me to lecture on the greatness of Southern literature, I decided I'd try to find the single most important reason for that greatness and explore it in depth, I might be doing it in death too. It's been a long project. rather than rush through a list of a dozen or 200 attributes of Southern literature, which would give you an abstract run through, I could do that too. I probably used to do that in my classes, and that's probably the reason for the serious decline in the arts and sciences enrollment, I think, today, down to 50% of what it used to be. But I won't do that to you. I want to choose one and explore it in depth. So in choosing that central reason for the literature's greatness, I resisted speaking on the importance of place, the oral narrative tradition, humor, fidelity to language, reliance on specifics rather than abstracts, which is kind of the Southern nemesis, the centrality of family, so important in Southern literature, the closeness to nature over the urban industrial, that's so central to Southern literature. So I could go on, but that's not what I'm going to do. I've chosen an attitude, an attribute that I judge to be far and away the key to the writing's continued worth and success. Faulkner provides a recognizable good example, so I'll be using examples from Faulkner, but the long continuum of Southern letters applies as well, and I've spent over 50 years reading some of the canon of Southern literature to be able to say this is sort of the thread, the main thread that I find. And it allows then in-depth exploration of what is truly Southern about Southern literature. And in this choice, I've relied on Cleanth Brooks, Alan Tate, Donald Davidson, Richard Weaver, my own work on William Gilmore Sims, Larry Brown, Harry Cruz, Cormac McCarthy, Flannery O'Connor, a long list, and Faulkner, of course. I did my dissertation on Faulkner. Then the Southern humorists, whom I admire, the antebellum Southern humorists. So here goes. In Faulkner's Go Down Moses, the character Ike McCaslin, in his usual idealistic and irrational ramblings, full of non sequiturs and wishful thinking, declares that man isn't quite God himself yet, implying that he is on the way. Richard Gray, in his 1994 biography of Faulkner, says that this is, quote, the voice of Faulkner, already preparing for his Nobel Prize acceptance speech. I'm glad you find that amusing. Richard Gray is now my replacement at the University of Georgia. He's an Englishman, and he's done some very good work. But Gray, Professor Gray, ignores the response to Ike from the reasonable Wyatt, who asks McCaslin, when will he be God? He's a finite Southerner's mind. When? To that question, Ike answers that when a man and woman have sex, it don't even matter whether they marry or not. The two of them are God. It's this dialogue that's so interesting. To that, Edmonds answers, then there are some gods I wouldn't want to touch him with a damn long stick. Edmonds then looks at Wyatt and adds, and that includes me. Edmonds has gotten a woman pregnant. She's looking for him, and he's running. some God. The good reader should conclude. So critics of the wishful thinking school would have Faulkner made in the Emersonian mold of man's infinite possibilities, even to becoming God on earth. Unfortunately, Faulkner's latest biography must be continuing the tradition of earlier Faulkner criticism in this respect. The traditional Southerner has always understood that man is flawed and his earthly possibilities are finite. There's the finitude. Okay? Faulkner subscribed to the Delphic motto, "Know thyself." That is, know your place as the created, not the creator. Emerson has it, know thyself means self-reliance and cultivating the divine spark of the oversoul to such a degree that man can create a heaven on earth. That's the modern way, as we've already learned, okay, from yesterday. So we have to recall Professor Carlton's distinction between pre-modern and modern. And it's going to sound like we wrote this together, but it's good to have reinforcement now from the literary side, okay? Man's limitations have been fully impressed upon the Southerner by his culture in two ways. First, he had the lesson taught by farming and his agrarian culture that the farmer cannot control the weather. Believe me, I know. As Andrew Lytle put it succinctly in his essay in Who Owns America, when man becomes vainglorious and thinks he can conquer nature and forgets his right role in nature, religion grows weak. Now we know why. The farmer's relation to his creator only gets stronger. Of the philosophy that man is in control, Lytle declared, "This the good farmer knows to be nonsense." Lytle was a farmer. He was a practical farmer. A second lesson in man's finitude for the Southerner came as the result of a lost war which other parts of America did not experience. It may be argued that the non-Southerner has developed a hubris of unlimited success to the point of attempting to play God with the world. The Secular Humanist Manifesto, framed by Northern academics and intellectuals in 1933 and again in 1973, is proof of this attitude. Written by a benevolent technocratic elite, scientists, this is a quotation from Margaret Mead, I don't do that very often, scientists elevated to the status of priests wrote this. Scientists elevated to the status of priests. Its thesis ran thus, since there is no God, man must take God's part and engineer the future. The methods would be through a technocracy of reason and science, even science applied to the mind. The Skinner box becomes a reality. Francis Schaeffer has treated the subject ably in the Humanist Religion chapter in his volume, A Christian Manifesto, which I would recommend to you. It was published in 1982. It's called A Christian Manifesto. It'll be a hard book to find, but it would be worth it. The South told a different story about man's unlimited powers to her children. From the South's history, the Southerner developed a tragic sense, not a blithely optimistic one. In one of his most discerning essays, Richard Weaver called the American attitude of no limits, quote unquote, that of a petulant adolescent spoiled by getting everything he desired, and very different indeed from the Southerner matured by hardship and hard realities. One recalls Quentin Compson saying in Absalom, Absalom, I am older at 20 than some people who have died. Weaver wrote that a, quote, dominantly Christian point of view has preserved in the South the idea that man can fall. This is why Southern literature, within the context of Southern belief, has been able to recover the theme of the greatest literature, unquote. He continued, tragedy is probably the most deeply educative experience. It is, in a sense, the typical experience. Southern writers have told much of that tragedy, and in doing so, they have told us important things about the human condition. Hence, We have yet another reason for that literature's appeal worldwide and its greatness. The violence of two world wars in Europe that occasioned an Amazon of blood, to quote George Garrett, it is hoped has become an educative experience in finitude for that continent. I think it already had it. It is not surprising that Faulkner was discovered by French literary critics and philosophers after World War II. The American establishment only began to take notice after the French made it fashionable, and then it really took after the Nobel Prize. Robert Penn Warren has talked about this, has much to say on the discovery of Faulkner in France. Perhaps Flannery O'Connor put the nature of man's finitude most succinctly. The Southern writer does not explain mystery, she declared, but instead deepens it. Now, this is in the preface to the second edition of Wise Blood. You won't find it anywhere else. Doesn't explain, but deepen. I think that's a really important quotation. This was certainly nothing new with O'Connor, and the roots of its wisdom ran deeper in Southern literature and culture than 1865. Southern realist Thomas Bangs Thorpe, in 1854, described his Southern hunter, Jim Doggett, of the Big Bear, let me say that right, Jim Doggett, not Doggett. We have to watch our language, don't we? Jim Doggett of the Big Bear of Arkansas in much the same way as O'Connor. The unhuntable Big Bear awes him to a, quote, grave silence owing to the, quote, mystery of the thing that he could never understand. Thorpe called it some superstitious awe, a feeling common with all children of the wood. Thorpe perceptively caught and portrayed the Southern sense of awe at the unexplainable that is the source of what is essentially a religious response to nature. Okay. Wendell Berry's most recent poems, I'll give an example, Sabbaths, The particular poem is Sabbath 2009. This poem brings us down to the present in seeing the Southern writer's rejection of modern man's insistence on trying to pin down existence into quantifiable certainties. He writes, in a time gone mad for certainty, maybe gives room to live and move and be. Berry's maybes presupposed, quote, how little I know in my widest waking. The poem speaker is aware of the world as a great weight he has no way of weighing, the unweighable weight that registers only in the heart. Okay. The speaker completely rejects his time's rage for quantification. Berry's book length, Life is a Miracle, another book I recommend heartily, Life is a Miracle, a formidable debunking of uninspired and arrogant science's cult of empiricism and of playing God with the world, in its own way, a technocratic brand of superstition, as Berry persuasively argued. In questioning God's punishment of good man, Job gets answer from the voice in the whirlwind, an answer in the form of a question. You probably know your Bible better than I. The voice in the whirlwind looks at Job and says, where were you, little man, when I hung the stars and laid the foundations of the earth? Where were you, little man? That's all Job needs to hear, and that's all he needs to know. Wisdom follows in the way of Delphi. He learns his little place before the infinite I am. Many Southern writers have shared Job's wisdom. As Weaver wrote, the loss of war underscored that understanding. But I would say that it was there long before 1865. That's how I would, I think, add a little to his sentence, which is absolutely true. William Gilmore Sims began his sack and destruction of the city of Columbia with references to none other than Job. Okay. Fred Chappell, in a very recent novel, as the voice in the whirlwind, silence the egos of his characters with the proper reverence of silence. For once, the characters all stop talking. The hubris of taking God's place has not been the way of wisdom for the South. Okay. Cleanth Brooks read Faulkner brilliantly. He traced a long continuum of American non-Southern millennialism in Northern literature from Emerson, Whitman, even Hawthorne in The House of Seven Gables. We forget that. Even Hawthorne nodded. Brooks wrote that the powerful force of no limits idealism and accomplishing anything if you just work hard enough and set your mind to it is to this day referred to, quote, rather fondly as simply the American dream. It's not the Southern dream. Brooks concluded that the issue of millennialism is, however, one that sets Faulkner off from a great many other American writers. Brooks quoted historian C. Van Woodward to good purpose. Woodward wrote, quote, an age-long experience with human bondage and later with emancipation and its shortcomings did not dispose the South very favorably towards such American popular ideas as the doctrine of human perfectibility, not to mention becoming God on earth. Brooks rightly declared that Faulkner was particularly concerned that the United States might be, quote, undone by her sometimes overweening faith in the future by her belief that progress was inevitable, by reliance on technology, sociology, and sociological solutions, and most dangerous of all, by her unprecedented record of military victories, so that non-Southerners might get the impression that they were immune to defeat, loss, and evil, an innocence that might in the end prove disastrous. Now, this is from Brooks' second book on Faulkner, which nobody ever reads. The first one is William Faulkner, The Yacht in the Potomac Country, 1962. This book, which I recommend heartily, I was amazed at reading it a second time that this might be better than the first. It's called Toward Yocnopatawpha. It's about the non-Yocnopatawpha works. In other words, the first dealt with the Yocnopatawpha works, and the second, Toward Yocnopatawpha, deals with the non-Yocnopatawpha works. And since they're not as great as the Yocnopatawpha works, he had more time to explore and give ideas philosophical and cultural. The idea that man can play God has always had disastrous results. Anyone who reads the Greek tragedies has known this truth right away, and that's why the classics are so important. And it is important to say here that traditional Southerners, as was the case of Faulkner, studied their Latin and Greek early and late. And that was the origins of Southern literature, a talk that I gave last time, and you can get that from Mike. And we talk about the classics as origins. Okay. Southern writers as a group have questioned the secular humanistic stance that since there's no God, it is left to man to act as God and engineer the future. Perhaps Southern Archibald Rutledge, whom we've explored here, phrased it best in his little book, Life's Extras, published in 1928. I have often heard people say that they would like to remake the world. Well, I'm glad we don't have to live in a man-made world. How impossible would be an earth and a scheme of life man had made? Rutledge continued that it is the sophisticated persons who dream so, but he feels that sophistication, quote, instead of being a proof of enlightenment and culture, is the evidence of ignorance and perhaps of folly. The great trouble with a sophisticated person is not that he knows too much, but that he knows too little. Rutledge apparently had no problem with the proper understanding of the Greek motto at Delphi, know thyself, know your place. In My Colonel and His Lady, one of my favorite Rutledge books, published in 1937, Rutledge, sounding very much like Faulkner, wrote that, quote, modern boasted progress may be valiant, but not especially interesting. For no material greatness can ever satisfy the heart. It cannot live by bread alone. Listen to that, Chamber of Commerce. In Rutledge, we again see the old patrician values of the pre-modern landed gentry in play against a modern bourgeois value system based on material wealth at the expense of the civilizing virtues. Likewise, Rutledge made light of the new technocracy that took itself so seriously. He was a man who lived on the land, lived according to nature's rhythms, and never aspired to remake the world in man's image, most expressly his own, which it usually is, right? It's all about me. You know the liberal? It's all about me. Me, mine, mine, me. The me generation. Well, in his brief review of Hemingway's The Old Man and the Sea, Faulkner observed that in this novel, Hemingway had for the first time discovered something greater than Hemingway. God, a creator. Isn't this wonderful? All it takes is one sentence in a book review by Faulkner. He has about 20 book reviews. Yeah, I read them. He's the best critic, I think, we've ever had. In one line, he does more than some people can do in five books. But anyway, he discovered God. Heretofore, he says, Hemingway's characters had made themselves, shaped themselves out of their own clay. This man knew his Bible. You better believe it. Let me give you just a little sidebar here. Got to quit doing that. When I went to Roanoke in 1970, Roanoke was Faulkner's house, I was able to kind of explore, and I found his New Testament in the drawer under his typewriter. It was a little pocket New Testament. That didn't make it into the catalog of his books. So write that down. I saw it. You can quote me. Okay, sidebar. In the Hemingway review, as at every turn in his fiction, Faulkner showed that he was acutely aware of the limitations of man and understood that man, no matter how heroically striving, cannot create himself in the way of modern progressive secularism. He does not try to elevate man to the Creator's throne or believe man can shape himself out of his own clay. O'Connor's Wise Blood provides a brilliant corollary in the image of the man-made replacement of God's throne on which modern man sits and holds sway over his dominion. The throne is a gilded toilet. And the man is a little shrunken man with sawdust, filled with sawdust, sitting on the gilded throne. When your dad goes and sits on the throne, you know. Okay. This mummy filled with sawdust. Though it's gilded, it's still a toilet. Alan Tate, on the subject of such gilded thrones, said that flush toilets were good things if one did not have to kneel down and worship them. Now, this was in a time when your status, economic status, was determined by how many telephones you had, or if you had a telephone, how many toilets you had, that sort of thing. And I think he's reacting to that. He's probably still using the outhouse, he and Caroline Gordon. But Faulkner did. When he moved into Roanoke, he didn't have a bathroom inside, he used an outhouse. He didn't have electricity and running water and plumbing in 1929. He used gas oil lanterns at night. You don't hear that. I got that from his brother Murray. Murray Faulkner's memoir of William Faulkner is better than any biography I've ever read, because it really gets to the center of things. But I won't get on to that. Faulkner was a real preservationist, and I love him for it because I've had to do similar things. Faulkner restored Roanoke, was falling down and termite eaten by himself. He loved to do carpenter work. And that's why you have all that imagery of carpentry and as I lay dying in all these books. Even in the Nobel speech, he talks about the writer's craft in terms of carpentry. Not a whole lot of people talk about that either, but that's the personal Faulkner that I really admire. So anyway, Faulkner saw man as imperfect by nature and unperfectible, but also possessing an indomitable spirit and will to endure, and capable of courage and bravery, of love and honor and pity and pride and compassion and sacrifice. Man's dual nature is often expressed in his characters in Faulkner's justly famous phrase, the human heart in conflict with itself, a heart imperfect and unperfectible, and man, as Weaver phrased it, the riddle, jest, glory, and unquantifiable mystery. This view of finitude and limitations is certainly diametrically opposed to the modern liberal progressive premise that man is by nature essentially good and perfectible by utopian means. What Eugene Genovese came to call, quote, the less rosy view of human nature. Quoted from a recovering Marxist. Genovese, in fact, drew attention to the Southern conservative understanding that man is finite before the infinite I am, a legacy of this society's Christian underpinnings. In The Catholic Novelist in the Protestant South, Flannery O'Connor became eloquent upon the subject. She wrote, quote, what has given the South her identity are those beliefs and qualities which she has absorbed from the scriptures and from her own history of defeat and violation, a distrust of the abstract, a sense of human dependence on the grace of God, and a knowledge that evil is not simply a problem to be solved, but a mystery to be endured. The first collection in which this essay appeared was appropriately entitled Mystery and Manners. Okay, we've had that yesterday. In her usual succinct, incisive way, O'Connor's essay pinpointed several traits of the Southern writer, traits she, Faulkner, and most Southern writers shared in common. So you can see the great body of great Southern literature, it seems to adhere nicely. And the more you read, the more you say, oh my, look at that. So now I've added this just this morning. Here I go. This is a postscript directed to the South's enemies. I wrote this other quite a while back. At the end of the 19th century, Uncle Remus, that wise Southern philosopher, had his own proverb about man's overreaching reasonable bounds. He warned, be careful when you're getting all you want. Fattening hogs ain't in luck. Maybe I should stop with that. That's good advice for everybody, us too. But we haven't had a lot of that lately, you know, getting all we want. Be careful when you're getting all you want. Fattening hogs ain't in luck. And I don't think you have to be a hog farmer to know what that means. What happens to fattened hogs? No doubt the reason few have heard this proverb in our time is that Uncle Remus is just too uncomfortably applicable. I think there are more reasons than racism that you don't read Uncle Remus. Uncle Remus's Songs and Sayings and all those books by Joel Chandler Harris, they're the most beautiful crystallization of Southern philosophy, which can't be voiced. So you get the label. If you teach, I got told I was racist because I taught Uncle Remus. And then I was also told what Uncle Remus should have done to the little boy. I said, well, it's good for race relations. Uncle Remus and the little white boy, they have a good relationship. I said, what should Uncle Remus have done? This is the quote. He should have killed the little white boy. I shouldn't have said that. It really hurts. But yeah, that happened. I can give you the date, the time, and the person. So that's what you're up against in academia, especially if you teach Southern literature, and I did for so long. The planet changed underneath my feet as I was teaching Southern literature. I can tell you about that personally in conversation. But Uncle Remus in his own day was running counter to the fashion of Victorian Gilded Age in America. He ran counter to progressive bigger is better, no limits, restraint, classical or otherwise. We had that word mentioned nicely. Has never been an American virtue. Restraint has never been an American virtue. It, not in the recent times. It has been a Southern virtue from the start. Southern manners teach it as a basic. So does the code of the gentleman. General Lee comes to mind. His advice to those who have power over the weak is that having that power is the very best reason not to exercise it. Because you have the power, then you are not to exercise it. And here's a quotation from a man whose statues they're trying to take down. Bigger is not always better, as Vince knows. I'm kind of preparing the way for you. All right. More is not always better. As Sims wrote, there should be limits to man's desiring. Well, that's scriptural. So now we'll go back. That was what I wrote this morning. Now, one reason for the modern idealism of an unlimited future and of man becoming God is his great triumphs in science and technology. Oh, well, look at the machine. This is what man has done. A questioning of the cult of technology and its machine culture. That's the phrase I always use. Machine culture. The agrarians used the term technocracy. That's not my invention, but I would say use that term. I like that term. It really applies, the technocracy. This questioning of the cult of technology has been an abiding theme in Southern literature, at least from the time of William Gilmore Sims, whom I know quite well. That's in the antebellum period. And you bring it on down to the present in a novel. I guess I would call this the novel of ultimate absurdity in Southern literature. Harry Cruz's novel, Car is its title, simple title. It's published in 1972. The main character loves that American symbol of technology so much that he wants it inside him, and thus he eats a maverick, a little piece at a time, before television cameras, and complete with televised defecations of car bits and blood, you might expect. That's Harry Cruz, you know, blood and grits. The painful feat does not satisfy, however, and only the promoters profit, usually the way. This American love story with the car is a futile attempt to find meaning. It ends in severe pain and frustration. It's a book you read. I mean, Harry Cruz is one of us. He's really... thematically, you have to get over that gore and some of the sensationalism. The message is there, okay? One is again reminded of Sims, who wrote in 1842 that not all the steam power in the world can bring happiness to one poor human heart. It's a direct quote. All the railroads in the world cannot carry one poor soul to heaven. Hawthorne used that for the Celestial Railroad. Hawthorne borrowed a lot from Sims. And about that business with Hawthorne, Hawthorne and Melville were the no-sayers in the American Renaissance tradition of Walt Whitman and all those yay-sayers, see? And so you have that split in the American Renaissance of the 1850s. So Hawthorne even had his bad downtime, so... with a book like The House of Seven Gables. He wasn't perfect. All right. The fugitive agrarians questioned the cult of science and industry throughout I'll Take My Stand. That's their term, the cult of science. The agrarians fought what Donald Davidson called in 1958, and this is a book you got to read. It's called The Southern Writers and Their Tradition. That's a little-known book, but it's as good as anything he wrote. So in 1958, He said, "The new barbarism of science and technology, controlled and directed by the modern power state." Throughout the collection, Who Owns America, in 1936, the authors called the modern state, the modern power state, the technocracy. Again, capital T. All right. Eugene Genovese explored the traditional Southern critique of bourgeois materialism and what he called the cult of scientism, which is very close to the agrarian comment, paid special tribute to the authors of I'll Take My Stand. He saw their stance to be representative of Southern conservatism through the ages. He wrote, "Southern conservatism has from its origins constituted America's most impressive native-born critique of her national development of liberalism and the more disquieting features of the modern world." That's high praise, the only American critique. And the modern world reacted in typical fashion by ignoring them at best and ridiculing them at worst. A good study could be made of the reaction to I'll Take My Stand by the critics. And the reactions came across regional bounds. It'd be a really good work. Although Faulkner, in the hands of his biographers and critics, has not usually been mustered to the side of Southern tradition, he most definitely deserves to be there. Faulkner wrote in 1946, quote, "Maybe a group of dismal swamp or Florida Everglades abolitionists will decide to free the country from machines." In discussing the Northern War upon the agrarian South, he declared, "The machine that defeated the Northerner's enemy, my people, was a Frankenstein which, once the Southern armies were consumed, turned on him and, removing him from a middle class fixed upon the land, translated him into a baronage based upon the slavery of machines." That's a Faulkner you don't hear about very often. One should note carefully the words, "removing him from a life fixed upon the land." Faulkner's purchase of the 300-acre Greenfield farm reestablished that tie to the soil and reversed the process of deracination. What his family had been removed from, he returned to. The phrase "fixed upon the land" is of particular relevance to that comment. Like Wendell Berry, Faulkner was a great advocate of staying put, and his life demonstrated it. A century before Sims's primary thesis, The Social Principle, was that Southerners should not leave their ancestral homes. How could one leave the graves of one's people, after all? He asked. How could one leave the graves of one's people? For him, staying put was the foundation for civilization. As critic of the machine culture, Faulkner was certainly out of step with an America assured of infinite and unlimited progress through technology, the universal panacea. You know how it is. If technology creates a problem, you create more technology to solve the problem. If that sounds insane, it is. But it's really good for the industrial machine to crank out more. Berry, too, has been our current major questioner of the efficacy of the machine. And you know his story probably well enough. Americans consider the things that Faulkner and Berry reject necessities. In the 21st century, there's an increasing number of questioners, but in their day in America, Southern writers have stood virtually alone. Now, in England, you have Chesterton, Tolkien, Belloc, others. But in this country, and that's basically what Eugene Genovese was saying, in this country. In his beautifully written memoir of his brother, Murray, again, I go back to Murray Faulkner. That's a book you gotta read if you really want to know Faulkner. Murray Faulkner. He described his brother Bill as a man who refused electric gadgets. He never had or watched a television. Murray wrote that radio and television struck him with horror. He mentioned that he never watched one work, and had no intention of doing so. Now, that's a direct quote. Faulkner laughed and said that he had seen an article in a paper relating that some people in a large eastern city who lacked television sets would buy and erect sprouts, as he termed them, on the roof and tinny, so the neighbors would assume the presence of a TV set beneath the sprouts. Look at that agricultural image, sprouts. And he said, he laughed, and Murray says, he said, this is beneath my comprehension, beneath my comprehension. He only had a telephone at his house as a concession to his wife and daughter, Eve and little Eve, I guess. Murray wrote, he had a natural and a sustained aversion to the telephone anywhere, anytime, and under any conceivable circumstances. He would not use it, and the one time Murray called and Faulkner answered, Murray was so shocked at hearing Faulkner's voice on the line that he hung up before I could get my breath and identify myself. I can see that. He wondered if the telephone was an instrument of communication or an instrument of torture. Well, Murray, however, did describe his brother's joy at purchasing a garden tiller for the vegetable plot. Now, here's this other Faulkner with a garden tiller. Murray said he was like a child at Christmas with a new toy. Then there was Faulkner's love of the airplane and flying, as dramatized in his 1935 novel, Pylon. He drove a car, decidedly not new and out of fashion, but a car. Murray wrote, with him, an automobile was solely a means to get him to some place too far to walk. He had an old Ford touring car for years. He later had a cloth-top Jeep, and after that, a fiery red Rambler station wagon. I like that picture of Faulkner in a fiery red Rambler station wagon. So he feared man's dependence on an obsession with machinery. He's certainly no Luddite. As usual in most things, Faulkner did not take a fanatical stand on his disdain for the machine. What he scorned was the culture built around the machine and that worshipped it. The gilded toilet again, see? That was the true fanaticism. That's fanaticism, he would say. It was a matter of misplaced priorities that distressed him. And it did distress him. And you have his wonderful essays to show it. Faulkner wrote a letter to the local newspaper in 1946 after his daughter's dog was run over by a speeding motorist. The letter shows so many of the traits of Southern writers that I think I'll read a little bit of that letter. His name was Pete. He was just a dog, a 15-month-old pointer. He expected little of the world into which he came. Food, he didn't care what nor how little, just so it was given with affection. A touch of a hand, a voice he knew even if he could not understand and answer the words it spoke. The earth to run on, air to breathe, sun and rain in their seasons, and the coveted quail, which were his heritage, long before he knew the earth and felt the sun, whose scent he already knew from his staunch and faithful ancestry. Before he himself had ever winded it, that was all he wanted. But that would have been enough to fill the 8 or 10 or 12 years of his natural life, because 12 years are not very many. Yet short as 12 years are, he should normally have outlived 4 of the kind of motor cars which killed him. That's a beautiful little jab at the shoddy throwaway society. So he continued, but Pete didn't outlive the first of the 4. He wasn't chasing it. He was standing on the road waiting for his little mistress on the horse to catch up, to squire her safely home. He shouldn't have been in the road. He paid no road tax, held no driver's license, didn't vote. The driver was in a hurry. Perhaps he was already late for supper. That was why he didn't have time to slow or stop or drive around Pete. And since he didn't have time to do that, naturally, and he didn't have time to stop afterward. Besides, Pete was only a dog flung, broken, and crying into a roadside ditch. But Pete has forgiven him. In his year and a quarter of life, he never had anything but kindness from human beings. He would gladly give the other 6 or 8 or 10 of it rather than make one late for dinner. Well, essay speeches and public letters of Faulkner are must read. If you really want to know Faulkner again, read his own words and then test the books you're reading against what he actually said. He's very honest. Don't go to any critic. Don't even go to me, as wonderful as I am. Yeah, the explicating thing. Go to Faulkner's own words, essay speeches and public letters. Okay. So in this, we noted, I think, that withering disdain for the regimentation of road taxes, driver's licenses, and the like, all considered more important than courtesy, responsible action, decency, and a respect for life. And for Faulkner, hurry seemed to be the new way that prevents civility and neighborliness and humanity. Finally, there are those academics who grant that Faulkner is Southern, but would have him a New South Southerner, a New South progressive Southerner. Oh, the critics. Perhaps this is a way to make a Southern writer more acceptable to certain circles of academia, or perhaps it's wishful thinking. Academics might ask, after all, how could a great genius not be progressive like me? You know, critics always make over a writer in their own image, and I'm doing that a little too here, you know? I got a lot in common with Faulkner. I'm picking out of Faulkner the things that appeal to me. That's what critics do, but don't distort. I'm not distorting Faulkner. The difference is distortion. I'm not distorting Faulkner. I'm letting Faulkner's words speak, and I'm not twisting his words or taking him out of context. So to address that issue, we may let Faulkner speak for himself in an essay he wrote as an introduction to another thing important, a new edition of The Sound and the Fury, which was proposed in 1933, but which never came out. So this introduction is about New South, about the New South. There's a thing known whimsically as the New South, but it's not the South. It is a land of immigrants who are rebuilding the towns and cities into replicas of towns and cities in Kansas, with skyscrapers and striped canvas awnings instead of wooden balconies, and teaching the young men who sell the gasoline and the waitresses in the restaurants to say, oh yeah, and to speak with hard R's. And hanging over the intersections of quiet and shaded streets where no one save northern tourists and Cadillacs and Lincolns ever pass at a gait faster than a horse trot, changing red and green lights and savage and peremptory bells. This is an angry Faulkner. Savage and peremptory bells and street lights hung over the corners of streets. The impersonal and mechanical command of savage and peremptory bells. In another piece, Faulkner had already been critical of cash register bells. Those old cash registers had bells on them, and I think that's what he's talking about. Chamber of Commerce? Here the bells may have extended to railroad crossings, fire engines, city trolley cars, pedestrian crosswalk bells, the usual barrage of noisemakers in an urban environment. Faulkner valued silence. He has several pieces on silence. He valued silence tremendously, as his writings reveal. The urban assault on the senses raised his ire. He felt that a culture and society that devised such peremptory bells were themselves savage and peremptory, and only deserving of his scorn, which he certainly did, obviously. In the tone of this passage, one hears the withering disdain of his character Elnora, who says, trash, town trash. She's the house servant for the patrician family in the country. Trash, town trash. A man consciously heir to the old squirearchy, as Faulkner was, would certainly be able to deliver the indictment quite effectively, knowing precisely what he was indicting and why. And he tells us. Once again, Sims has provided a striking corollary. He felt that in 1865, defeat in war left the old Southern codes of chivalry and civility in tatters before a triumphant, impersonal, burgeoning, industrial, urban machine culture that only valued getting rich and getting ahead at all cost. In other words, a vulgar and boorish and very un-Southern Chamber of Commerce mentality. It should be noted that the Chamber of Commerce is a national organization, really a business with a CEO, and local chapters pay their dues to the headquarters in Washington. For this, the locals receive very little except a tax on their heritage, which the locals usually believe in and support. To me, this sounds like bad business. Bad business. Near the end of his writing career in January 1870, Sims predicted that a people who forswear chivalry and high ideals in their rush to power and materialism will fall into tyranny and commit cultural suicide. That's his prediction. Sims hurled the curse of the poet, the bardic curse of the poet, on the victors, for whom the words chivalry and gentleman have become, quote, a sort of scoff, especially as they perpetually heard of these virtues from European tongues as belonging to Southerners. Sims concluded, there was an awful consciousness among many of them born yesterday, and with no other capital of character than a fashionable tailor could make, assisted by some stolen crest from some English gentleman's carriage, that there was a very substantial difference in the training and development of the two sections. And there's the divide between pre-modern and modern, one more time coming to us. Instead of coming together as one people, Sims felt that we were diverging. He said we're getting further and further apart. And the war was going to be another reason for it. So, that's what C. Van Woodward, that northern way, is what C. Van Woodward phrased a cash register evaluation of life. That's a good term, a cash register evaluation of life. And in Faulkner, that cash register would have savage and peremptory bells. Okay. I'm going to finish with this. Georgia essayist John Donald Wade, whom you should know, he was my predecessor at the University of Georgia. A lot to live up to there. John Donald Wade, in his chapter in Who Owns America, wrote of the unsouthern arrogance of the city in feeling superior to the country. Size, machines, things out of human scale, technocracy had made the city dweller proud. Wade wrote, however, the principle of metropolitanism is basically parasitic. It leads man to the folly of thinking he is invincible. The validity of his understanding rests in size and number and not in quality and spirit. Wade, along with the traditional wisdom of many Southern writers, concluded that, quote, the essential thing about human endeavor is not how large it is, but how human it is. That's just such good common sense. And of course, good common sense is out. It's a demonic world. Flannery O'Connor saw it. Everything's backwards. So anyway, Wade declared that man was not to shape his humanity after the machines that he's made, because the machine model leads to, quote, a devouring torture chamber. And that's what most cities are, as far as I'm concerned. You think I'll ever go back to Atlanta? No. I rubbed up against one of their concrete rough buildings by mistake, and my hide was taken off my arm. Yeah. I went into one of those awful parking garages, and I thought I was in Dante's Inferno. It's a good image. Well, Wade found it even more disturbing to see the trend of the country beginning to idolize the city. For Wade, this admiration meant, quote, going after spuriousness and vulgarity. and independence paying tribute to parasitism and humanity becoming a machine. That's good. These last descriptions of the drift of the new way are a good statement of what most Southern writers in the Southern literary tradition did not do, and a description of the values of the technocracy they have eschewed. Their humanity and insistence on keeping mankind human has perhaps been their greatest legacy. And you see, Emily and I agree 100%, and we have not shared these essays. Their humanity and insistence on keeping mankind human has perhaps been their greatest legacy. It is certainly a basic attitude of their writing that will remain pertinent and timeless. This in no way is at the center of the greatness of Southern literature, and it stems from the recognition of man's finitude. I thank you so much for your...